Welcome to BBC What's New. First up, take a look at these cute monkeys.
Oh, they're so sweet. But what exactly are they?
Well, these guys are red colobus monkey, and they can only be found on the island of Zanzibar off the coast of Tanzania. Like many species in the world, they're endangered. And at one point, there were only about 2,000 of them left.
Wow. Sadly, it is a common problem. According to a major study called the Living Planet Report, humans are damaging wildlife habitats across much of the world. Is that happening with these guys?
No. The good news is that they are a conservation success story. There's been a huge effort to save this monkey, and it seems to be working. Let's find out more.
There are over 250 species of monkeys in the world. But the Zanzibar red colobus monkey is considered quite special. Only found in Zanzibar, it's known for its unique eating habits, lovely red fur on its back, and is thought to be very, very friendly.
So now we're here at Jozani Forest, which is famously home to the Zanzibar red colobus monkey. They're an endangered species, and we're here to meet one of the guides who's helping to save them.
At one time, there's an incident where some farmers killed at least 50 Zanzibar red colobus monkeys because they were perceived as a threat. Now, there are concerted efforts to help maintain the monkey population and their habitat.
In Jozani, what efforts have you made to make sure that, you know, they are no longer in danger?
The government is trying to involve local communities in conservation. For instance, yeah, if you do calculations, 50% of the revenue collected from Jozani Shaka Bay National Parks goes to local communities.
In the last census that you did, have the numbers improved or is it the same?
The number has been increasing. Previously, there were around 2,000. 3 years ago, the number has been increasing up to 5,800.
Zanzibar red colobuses play an important role in tourism, which is one of Zanzibar's most important economic sectors. Thousands of tourists visit Jozani National Park to see these primates, and this generates thousands of dollars in earnings as park fees. Habib has worked at Jozani for over 20 years and loves all the features that make this monkey unique.
They don't eat ripe fruit like other species of monkeys. Like, they have four chambers of stomach which are unable to digest the sugars. And it's very strange, they feed on charcoals. This charcoal helps them in digestion system as well as to get rid of some poison materials.
What's the one thing that you think is so special about them that you love about them?
I love them, especially their behavior. Their behavior, because unlike other species of monkeys, they're really used to people, they never attack you.
So hopefully, future generations can visit the forest to see this beautiful primate.
Oh, it's great that things are going so well there. And there's also good news for these animals, as China has decided not to lift a ban on the trade of tiger bones and rhino horns.
That's right. Environmental groups protested after China said it would allow their remains to be used for medical, scientific and cultural purposes.
The horns and bones are particularly valuable in Chinese medicine, but campaigners said lifting the ban would devastate remaining animal populations. It's thought that there are only 30,000 rhinos and fewer than 4,000 tigers living in the wild.
Kenya's new coast guards have taken to the seas and they're out to hunt down illegal fishermen and stop smuggling.
The country's president says illegal fishing is costing the country $100 million a year. The new service was launched in Mombasa.
And these very happy Cameroon fans are just some of those who've touched down in Ghana for football's Africa Women's Cup of Nations.
Oh, yes. Eight teams are taking part, including Nigeria, Zambia and South Africa.
The final will be on December the 1st.
Hey, guys, my name is Mr. Easy and you're watching BBC What's New. Zagadat.
Now, Ben,
yes.
You love taking photos, right?
Oh, you are right, Deb. People call me the selfie king. Yeah! But my photos of other people could use a little bit of work.
Mm-hmm. Well, have a look at these.
Ooh.
Yes. They were all taken by Moyinolua, a 7-year-old photographer from Nigeria. She's taken incredible photos of some of the continent's biggest stars. Have a look at this.
is Mariana Rodolashan. I'm 7 years old. I take pictures. When a person is more taller than me, or there's a group of people, and me, I'm too short. All I need to do is just climb a chair to take from their head to their feet. I started taking pictures when I was 4, but I started with a camera when I was 2. Sometimes we go to school, come back very early to go take the pictures. I don't get distracted at school. My sister is my assistant. My mentor is my dad.
Allowing her to do photography, she must do well for school. So because say she knows say if she don't do well for school, we don't go allow her to do photography. We take her education very serious.
I'm so happy that she's an inspiration to other children, other kids, and even to adults.
If they say you cannot do it, show them that you can do it.
Wow, she is such a good photographer. Now, if you're into football, you've probably spent hours debating this with your friends. Who is the best footballer around? Personally, I think Drogba is and always will be an absolute legend. But what about you, Deb?
Well, I know who I like, but it doesn't matter what we think because we want to know who your favourite African footballer is. And the 5 nominees for African Footballer of the Year 2018 have been announced.
Oh, yes. On the shortlist this year, we've got Mehdi Benatia from Morocco and Senegalese players Kalidou Koulibaly and Sadio Mane.
And Thomas Partey from Ghana, as well as Egypt's Mo Salah, who won last year's award. Now, it takes a lot of hard work to be as good as these guys. So we asked some of them what advice they'd give to aspiring young players.
My name is Sadio Mane.
Salut à tous, c'est Mehdi Benatia.
Hi, my name is Mohamed Salah.
I'm Thomas Partey.
I'm Kalidou Koulibaly.
To believe themselves and to tell themselves I can and I will do it.
Don't look at what other people have because it's difficult when you see other people in their cars and a lot of luxuries, you will be like motivated to get some at that early age.
Voilà, dans la vie, il y a personne qui te donne rien. Tout ce que tu as, il faut aller le chercher. Il faut travailler deux fois plus que les autres. Quand on est un joueur africain et qu'on joue en Europe, on sait tous que c'est pas facile tous les jours.
I think if you have discipline in what you want and if you believe really in what you want, you can have it.
It's a good question, but difficult question.
Of course, be positive on this way and try to make it better. Like, okay, I want this and do more.
Well, I would advise myself to leave Africa and start my football as early as possible in Europe.
Which is what you did. Yeah. Very successfully.
Or more younger, you know, like from... I should be born here to start.
Oh, il ne faut pas se plaindre, il faut justement saisir cette opportunité. Et il ne faut pas avoir peur de travailler deux fois, voire trois fois plus que les autres pour pouvoir être récompensé.
My mom tell me something. She tell me that look the way you are speaking with your friend and with your small brother. Don't do to people what you want, don't want people to do to you.
You can find out more about African Football of the Year 2018 and vote for your favorite by going to bbc.com/African Football. Now, you may have noticed that all the players on the list are outfield players. But what about goalkeepers? They never seem to get as much attention. A special goalkeeping academy in Somalia is trying to change that. Let's check it out.
Step by step, play by play, these young boys in Somalia are hoping to make it big in the future. Not by scoring goals, but by saving them.
I was one of the 11-year-old players who went to Qatar. I was the second goalkeeper. So I learned that goalkeepers need a lot of training, a different training from other players. I hope after this to go to many international tournaments.
I hope for a bright good future and my ambition is to be part of the players of a football league in Somalia. I would like to play internationally and around the world.
In Somalia, goalkeeping has been seen as not important, and many teams in the country only have one keeper. So if a goalie gets injured, an outfield player has to take over. The aim of the academy is to change the perception of the position.
In Somalia, goalkeeping is not a position many are interested in. Even when the manager selected his players, first he looks for forwarders, midfielders and defenders, but has no emphasis on seeking the best goalkeeper. But as you know in football, the goalkeeper's position is very important. If the goalkeeper is not a good player, the club will lose even if they have the best players.
By opening this school, Abdi Razak Gurajay hopes to nurture young talent.
In Somalia, every player is only interested in playing inside the field and don't like being a keeper. That's why when we play against the other nations, we lose. But I hope in the future, this academy will help reduce goalkeepers that help Somalia to victory.
After decades of turmoil in Somalia, improvements to all aspects of daily life in the country are happening. And as local administrations put more money into sports programs for young people, the government is hoping to keep them off the streets and in the country.
Let's head straight to California in the United States, where devastating wildfires have killed at least 80 people.
More than 200 more are missing, and thousands of people have had to abandon their homes and move to safety.
Wildfires can happen all over the world, but what causes them and how can they be prevented? Let's find out.
Wildfires, what are they? Wildfires are uncontrollable flames which can spread quickly and sometimes burn thousands of acres of land. These wildfires in California are thought to be the deadliest in history. More than 7,000 buildings have been destroyed and around 1 million acres of land burnt. So what causes wildfires to happen? Although wildfires can happen because of natural causes, such as lightning, most of them are started by people. According to NASA, 4 out of 5 wildfires are caused by human carelessness. For example, someone dropping their cigarette or leaving a campfire unattended. Wildfires are most common in the late summer and autumn, when the land is dry and leaves are falling from the trees. Droughts can make the problem worse, and strong winds are also dangerous, as they help the fire to spread even quicker. A wildfire can move as fast as 14 miles per hour. In California, the wildfires were so ferocious that they destroyed whole houses in minutes. The USA and Canada experience a large number of wildfires, but they are also common in Australia, South America, and closer to home in South Africa. In 2017, at least 8 people died in the Cape Town area after wildfires were fanned by strong winds and a severe drought. Even though they can be difficult to control, wildfires can be prevented. One of the methods is called controlled burning, where an area of land is purposefully burnt to stop the fire spreading, because the burnt land can't catch fire again. Another is to dig a trench or clearing in the vegetation that the fire can't cross. These are called fire breaks. Rivers and roads also act as fire breaks. Putting out wildfires takes a lot of people, money and machinery, and the operation can take several weeks. If the fire is big enough, helicopters and planes are brought in to drop water or special chemicals onto the flames that can slow and cool down the fire. In California, planes have been dropping thousands of litres of water onto the fires to try and put them out.
In California, firefighters are making progress in containing the wildfires and say they're doing their best to keep everyone safe. But it's not just humans that need protecting. Animals do too. People have been rescuing pets, livestock and a few other pretty special animals too. Here's Nora with more.
Stanley the giraffe is one of the many animals at Malibu Wine Safari in California. It's one of the attractions that's been badly affected by the wildfires here. But luckily, Stanley and the other animals were saved by their owner, 26-year-old Dakota Demler, and his family.
Because we were focused on our evacuation plan, which pays particular attention to life over property, we evacuated animals and people. And in the process, we lost most of our structures.
With everything from camels to pigs, how was Dakota able to get his animals to safety?
We had a trailer on standby for a large huff stock like Stanley, and we waited to see how close the fire line would approach. And around 7:38, we could see the fire actually coming over that hill right there where that big rock formation is. And that's when we decided that because of the nature of transferring a large exotic, an 18-foot giraffe in a 12-foot trailer is incredibly dangerous, we decided to shelter in place with him as well as with a few of our other animals.
With the fire in this area now under control, life can soon go back to normal for the safari.
Next up, albinism is a condition where someone doesn't have pigment in their skin or eyes. And children born with albinism often experience problems with their eyesight too.
In Kenya, this leads to them being sent to schools for blind children. But thanks to one eye doctor in Nairobi, hundreds of children with the condition have been given free treatment and can now attend non-specialist schools. Let's find out more.
For generations, the world actually focused only on the skin of a child with albinism. They did not take into consideration that the real disability or the real challenge people with albinism has is related to the eyes, because the melanin pigment is absent in the eyes. I'm Dr. Prabha Choksi. I'm an ophthalmologist and I'm founder of Dr. Choksi Albinism Foundation. My turning point was in 2007 when I came across the first people with albinism. And that's the time I actually felt that the real challenge or disability was the eyes. And I thought that I could do something to make a difference to them.
How are you? Where have you come from?
Because of lack of pigment melanin in the eyes, 100% of children, people with albinism, do not have 100% vision. So they do have very severe visual challenges. I thought that this was absolutely wrong, because these children could actually study in regular schools with prescription glasses. So every single Tuesday for the last 11 years, I've been giving my ophthalmic services free and providing all of them with free prescription photochromatic glasses. And I've reached almost 1,200 children with albinism. This is a totally misunderstood condition, and people did not even know that children with albinism are so extraordinarily brilliant. And that is what I want the world to tell. Don't take children with albinism to blind schools. They have enough sight to be able to attend regular schools. But the real core mission of my foundation, and which is very close to my heart, is to give a life of dignity and honor to every person with albinism in the world.
Next, he's clearly one of Africa's top comedians after finishing third on the huge TV show Britain's Got Talent. Yes, this week's big interview is with Malawian Daliso Chaponda. But why did he compete in the British version of the show when so many African versions exist? I went to find out.
Standing on the stage, got the whole place rocking. It's popping, no stopping.
Daliso Chaponda is an African comedian with a lot to say. He's Malawian, but born in Zambia, and he grew up in, well, I'll let him explain it.
I actually grew up all over the place because my father was working for the UN. My early years were spent in the places he was posted, which is Zambia, Somalia, Kenya. I ended up going to school in Swaziland, we're in Thailand, Austria. I'm a bit of everything.
Daliso hadn't heard of stand-up comedy being a job until he left the continent.
The first time I actually realized there was a separate art of telling jokes was in Canada when I walked into an open mic. So I wanted to jump on immediately. They said, no, you've got to sign up and then come next week. I had invited like everybody in my student residence. So I think it went great because it was my friends. There were like 60 of my friends in the audience, but either way, it got me started.
When did you think I was gonna go?
But what did his family think of his big decision?
Oh, initially they thought I was a maniac. There was like interventions and you know, prayers that to lead me back to the light. I didn't talk them around, I just did it. And then they turned around when they seen that I'm successful.
Daliso's career blew up after a little feature on one of the UK's biggest talent shows.
My tours used to, I used to have 50 people. My current tour, I have 1,000 people each show, so it's a whole different ballgame. 80 million people watch these videos. If you just get a little snippet of those who are your fans, they come to the shows, it's great. When I go to Africa, the reaction is insane. So in Malawi, I was met by people wearing Daliso t-shirts.
What?
Yes, the British ambassador threw a dinner in my honor. You have no idea how excited they were in Malawi. And I think the thing is this, to people in the UK, it's just me on a competition. But for a lot of Africans, it was like, look, there's an African like us doing well on this show. And so they embraced me in this kind of really tangible way, which is absolutely amazing. Yeah, so where are you from? Where are you from? You're from Ghana. What's your name? Tuesday? Wednesday?
But with the amount of talent shows in Africa, why didn't he go on one of them?
It's by far the most watched talent show. Like, one of the videos has got 100 million views. Yes. That is not going to happen on Malawi's Got Talent.
As much as we love it.
There's this really absurd thing that a lot of African artists have to go outside of Africa, get recognized there, then when you go back, you're a hero. So I've been funny for years, but now that I've been on Britain's Got Talent, I'm the most Malawian person. The same people who said to me, you fake Malawian, you don't even speak the language properly, and used to insult me, are now like, oh, you're so Malawian.
And what advice does Daliso have for you guys?
They have to just not say they want to be a comedian, they want to be an artist. Until you've been going a while, try everything. You might find that actually you are better at tap dance than stand-up comedy. You don't know.
Oh, you must have had a good laugh meeting him.
He was hilarious. And that's all from us this week. But before we go, check out these kids. They've just moved to Canada from Eritrea as refugees, and they'd never seen snow before until now.
Ah, they look like they're having such a good time playing in the snow for the first time.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us, and see you next time on What's New.
Bye.